Today is the 23rd April 2020, so it's my pleasure to welcome Reginald Hill. So he's an assistant professor of medicine at Keck School of Medicine of USC and Lawrence J. Ellison Institute for Transformative Medicine. His research focuses on pancreatic cancer, and his lab uses mouse model, human clinical samples, and also newly established assay systems that he's going to introduce to us today. So he's looking into addressing fundamental questions on how tumor microenvironment affects pancreatic cancer progression and therapeutic resistance. His lab has elucidated mechanism through EV from cancer-associated fibroblasts that can cause therapeutic resistance in pancreatic cancer. So welcome, Reginald.
Thank you very much. It's an honor for the organizers to have chosen me to give a talk. I'm very excited to share my work and to see so many old friends from Notre Dame and other places on today. Hope you like my beard. And so today I'm going to talk about our story, which is really looking at the role of the cancer-associated fibroblast-derived exosomes and how they regulate chemoresistance in pancreatic cancer. So this is just the outline that I'll cover today. First, I'll start by going over some background, which will include some statistics about pancreatic adenocarcinoma, the role of inflammation in this disease, and then I'll move on to our in vivo studies and talk about the novel mouse model of pancreatic cancer we made that takes into account the role of inflammation and acceleration and disease resistance. And then we'll move into studying the role of EV derived from exosomes and how that affects pancreatic chemo resistance. And then in a lot of new studies, what I want to talk about is the newly derived organoid system that we have. And we'll talk about how the ECM and EV hypersecretion chemo resistance is affected by a number of different factors in the extracellular matrix. And then finally, I'll talk about some of the compounds that we've tested that will actually block extracellular vesicle hypersecretion and finish off with some future directions and acknowledgments. So first, some background. And unfortunately, right now, pancreatic cancer is the third leading cause of cancer-related death in the U.S. We passed breast cancer a couple of years ago. And so although relatively few people, only about 50,000 people will come down with pancreatic cancer every year, almost 43,000 people will die every year. It's a very awful disease with very poor prognosis. One of the things we kind of look at and take into account when looking at diseases in cancer is the five-year survival rate. And unfortunately for pancreatic cancer, it has one of the lowest five-year survival rates. A lot of cancers that people study and have heard of a lot more, like breast cancer and prostate cancer, have five-year survival rates that are relatively high. Like breast cancer has almost a 90% five-year survival rate. Prostate cancer has a 99% five-year survival rate, while pancreatic cancer is one of the only cancers that has a five-year survival rate in the single digits. And one of the main reasons we see this is because the disease is actually only found in relatively late stages. Most of the time people come into the clinic when they're diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, the disease is already at an unresectable state. So only about a quarter of people are actually even candidates for surgical resection. And most of those patients actually don't have a very long prognosis for treatment or survival afterwards. And so this is a very nasty disease where patients have very long odds for survival. And so what we try to do is to really look at why we haven't made a lot of progress in pancreatic cancer treatment. So this is showing the five-year survival rates for most common cancers in the decades past and currently. So if you look at the 1970s and the 2000s, see that for a lot of cancers, we make some significant improvements in five-year survival rates. But all the way down here at the bottom of the list is pancreatic cancer. So we have 2.5% five-year survival rate a long time ago, and it's only, you know, around 9 or 10% now. And so this is a disease where we haven't made a lot of headway, and this is really why I decided to focus my lab on pancreatic cancer. So what do we currently know about PDAC? Well, first thing is that the pancreas is something that everybody is using, whether you're in America or Australia right now. If you use your pancreas, you used it for eating and digesting your breakfast, lunch, or dinner. It has three major cell types: the ductal cells, which carry out all the secretions of the pancreas, the islets, which produce things like insulin, and the acinar cells, which produce all of the enzymes that are needed to break down your food. But the interesting thing that we see in pancreatic cancer is that the primary tissue and the actual tumor tissue look very different. This is trichrome staining, which monitors and can detect collagen deposition. When we think about cancer, a lot of times people think about getting to the root of the problem. And to me, when I think about pancreatic cancer, I think of the soil of the problem, being the collagen-rich microenvironment that surrounds pancreatic cancer cells. What you're seeing here on the left is a normal pancreas, where most of the astrocyte cells are present. Now you see the complete change of the architecture on the right, where you see the trichrome marking all the collagen deposition that's occurring here in these areas where you see a lot of PDAC and pannin. Massive change of the architecture that wasn't there before. And so the question I've always been interested in is, how does this actual environment change the risk of pancreatic cancer development or the severity of the disease? And so inflammation has been linked to a lot of different cancers, and it's something I studied in other diseases, including prostate cancer. But to me, pancreatic cancer is very interesting because we know that there are many systems that will help pancreatic cancer progress, including growth factors that will sustain proliferative signaling, survival factors that will limit cell death, and pro-angiogenic factors that are all caused or driven by inflammation. So when we think about the hallmarks of cancer, one of the hallmarks of PDAC has always been this chronic inflammation that either precedes or is found alongside the disease. And so the focus I've always had is understanding what role does this inflammation play in the chemoresistance of the disease. And so how do we test the role of inflammation or other alterations in pancreatic ductal adenocarcinoma? And if you're me, you make a mouse model. Some of you follow me on Twitter, where I have the handle of mouse modelers because I've been trained in grad school to be mouse modeler. I've made a lot of different mouse models of cancer. And these are great because they allow us to test direct function of a gene. They can be great for evaluating novel strategies for early detection, chemo prevention, and treatment. And so when we look at how to create a mouse model, we usually start with what's actually altered. What we see in pancreatic cancer are KRAS mutations. You'll see one of the highest rates of one single mutation with cancer in pancreatic cancer with the KRAS mutation, where 90 to 95% of pancreatic cancer will have a mutation in KRAS. So when mouse models of pancreatic cancer were first produced, people used this KRAS oncogene to try to cause pancreatic cancer in the model of a mouse. And what they found, interestingly, was that while you see the production of pancreatic intraepithelial neoplasias or pannins in these mice, you don't really get a lot of pancreatic ductal adenocarcinoma. And this suggested that there are other steps, other alterations that are missing from this process that are necessary in order to get the full spectrum of tumor development that you see in humans. And so in order to actually recapitulate the full spectrum of tumor development, I looked at other alterations that could be necessary for this. And then I went to P10. P10 is one of the major tumor suppressor genes in the body, mutated and or altered in about probably 50% of cancers. And what I wanted to know was that in the context of an existing KRAS alteration, would P10 loss of function in some way possibly lead to pancreatic cancer formation? P10, very important in tumor suppression. We know it can block the activation of AKT, which can lead to increased cell cycle progression and suppressing cell death. So this was something I've studied in various phases of my career. And so what we set out to do was to take this activated KRAS gene, oncogene in the mouse, and remove P10 gene function to figure out if we could take what was previously a model that only got precursor pannin formation to see if it would actually lead to full-blown cancer formation. And that's actually what we got. I'm showing you here the heterozygous state because when we actually remove both copies of P10, these mice die of pancreatic cancer by day 14. So that's actually before we can wean them. It grows that fast. But what we see here in the heterozygous state, where we still have one functional copy of P10, is that the mice start to develop PDAC by 3 months of age, and by 6 months of age, all the mice have PDAC compared to KRAS mutated alone mice, which only have PDAC around 6 months of age in that time frame. And so having established this as kind of my base model, what I wanted to do then was to go back again to that role of inflammation. Cyclooxygenase 2 or COX-2 is one of the main mediators of cancer-related inflammation in the body. And interestingly, just like KRAS is found mutated early in the progression of lesions to full-blown cancer in situ, we see COX-2 overexpression very early in the progression of pancreatic adenocarcinoma as well. So what I wanted to do was to individually test the role of COX-2 overexpression, see if that inflammation alone could lead to PDAC formation. I'm not going to go through the data here, but I can tell you that COX-2 overexpression alone does not lead to full-blown tumor formation. So what I wanted to do then was to combine the COX-2 overexpression with the existing KRAS P10 heterozygous mouse model that already had established. So being able to test whether or not this KRAS mutation alone, which normally had precursor lesions, when combined with P10 haploinsufficiency would lead to cancer. The question was, if we add the inflammation from COX-2 overexpression, would we actually then see something different, and what would that be? So very luckily, what we saw is that the mice that have COX-2 overexpression in the context of KRAS and P10 compromised function have very accelerated tumor development. So now we're looking at 1 to 2 months of age. And what we see here is that these mice have tumors, full-blown PDAC by 1 to 2 months of age, compared to even the KRAS P10 het model, which I just a few minutes ago told you was really aggressive. They get tumors even faster. And so what's really interesting here is this tumor microenvironment. So what you can see here is a lot of desmoplasia, or this inflammation where you see a lot of the fibroblasts and the other cell types that are being recruited to this site. Again, looking at trichrome staining, we can actually mark and even quantify this collagen deposition in these lesions, even in their precursor state. So even the pannin lesions here, you can see with the more intense blue staining in the pannin mice here in the bottom row that has COX-2 overexpression, and then the tumors that have more expression of this collagen. So to me, this was the interesting area where we started to really get to the point where we could dig into what we wanted to study. So we could say that this COX-2-driven mouse model really mimicked the desmoplasia seen in human PDAC. So we could take a model that previously had very little inflammation or desmoplasia, add COX-2 overexpression to it, and really get that characteristic desmoplasia that looks like the human disease. You can generally look at this and not really tell the difference between this and the human tumor, which has mostly fibroblasts and desmoplasia. So this was really the model system that I wanted to use to make our studies and to establish the system that we wanted to look at. And so having established this, our lab wanted to look at the role of this desmoplasia in therapeutic resistance. Pancreatic cancer really has a major problem with having any drug that works. Most drugs have been tried in pancreatic cancer that worked in other areas, and it just fails. The median survival, even with advanced chemotherapies in pancreatic cancer, is a matter of months. This therapeutic resistance is kind of the major thing that I've always wanted to focus on. And so while we know that the tumor microenvironment could influence growth and metastasis, my lab currently majorly focuses on therapeutic resistance. I have a lot of projects related to ER stress and the role of the extracellular matrix remodeling, but what I'll talk about today primarily is the role of the fibroblast-derived exosomes. And so when we look at the tumor microenvironment, again, it's very complex. There are a lot of cells, and no matter what cell type you study, your favorite, you know, player in this game, it's going to be there. And so as I alluded to a lot earlier, my favorite player are the fibroblasts. The fibroblasts are interesting to me for a couple of reasons. One is the prevalence in pancreatic cancer. The tumor bulk in pancreatic cancer is actually fibroblasts. It can make up about 80 to 90% of the tumor bulk itself. So when you look at it, the actual cancer cells that I'm showing you here with the cursor are actually in the minority of the tumor cells. So all tumors have inflammation, but I'd never seen this level of desmoplasia in any other cancer. And it's one of the interesting questions as to why inflammation and desmoplasia are so severe in pancreatic cancer. Why do you have this fibrotic, collagen-rich environment? So to me, this has always been an interesting question as to how this underlying biology might actually help us to understand why we can't do better treating this disease. So it's understudied, but the bulk of the evidence suggests it's a very pro-tumorigenic function. And one of the things to me that was also interesting is that when we look at the role of these stromal cells, there's a lot of studies looking at how they might be a passive blockade, blocking chemotherapy from reaching the drug targets. And we do know that that is true to some degree. But to me, the interesting thing was that if you looked at tumors that were treated with, you know, saline or PBS compared to gemcitabine-treated tumors, you could see that Ki-67, a marker for proliferation, would go down in the epithelial cancer cells, meaning that we were successful in actually hitting the cells that we wanted to hit. You can see less epithelial cancer cells, But what persisted were the stromal cells. So to me, it was something that was really overlooked as in terms of what are the stromal cells, these fibroblasts and other cells doing in response to chemotherapy. When you treat a person with chemotherapy, all of their cells are being exposed to this therapy. So what are these cells actually doing? So this is kind of the niche that my lab works in, trying to look at the role, not of regular cancer-associated fibroblasts, which a lot of other people are doing, but specifically, how do the chemotherapy treatments that we give to patients, how are they actually affecting the fibroblasts, and what effect do these treatments then have on the normal cells and the tumor cells? And so the first thing we did in order to do this was to look at fibroblast-derived lines. And this was done with help graciously provided these resources from Dr. Melissa Fischel at Indiana University, who took patient-derived tumors and isolated cancer-associated fibroblast lines from these patients. And the first thing we did was to do all the classic, you know, experiments to verify smooth muscle actin staining and vimentin staining in the calf lines. I'm talking about three major lines here, which I'll refer to as calf 1, calf 2, and calf 3. And so the first thing I wanted to study was how resistant these calf lines were to gemcitabine. Gemcitabine being the nucleoside analog, which is kind of the major backbone for all treatments in pancreatic cancer patients. And what we see here in purple is that the cancer-associated fibroblast lines themselves were more resistant than our most drug-resistant epithelial cancer line here, like the PANC1 cells. So this to me was very interesting. It meant that intrinsically there was something different that was keeping these calf lines alive. Here you're seeing crashing out a drug-sensitive line, the L3.6 cell line. So having established that these cells were actually resistant to gemcitabine, I wanted to look at the mechanism. Kind of a lot of initial questions came up, several being like, maybe this is just something that is linked to proliferation. So maybe the cells are actually proliferating slowly, so that's why they don't take up the nucleoside analog, so that's why they don't die. But what we saw is that if you looked at the proliferation percentage rate that's retained, even highly proliferative cells or low proliferating cells, if they were calves, were still more resistant to gemcitabine. And even if you looked at comparable calf lines and epithelial cell lines that had the same level of proliferation, the calf line was always more resistant to chemotherapy. Then we kind of got to the question of saying, well, maybe these were cells that are undergone EMT or epithelial to mesenchymal transition. Maybe this could be responsible for what we're seeing. These are actually drug-resistant cancer cells. But we checked for all the basic, the classic markers that you see, chains and mutations you see in pancreatic cancer, KRAS mutation. We don't see any of those. So these are, you know, fibroblasts. And so do these chemo-resistant calves affect cancer epithelial cell behavior through secreted factors? We will think this would be a major mechanism that would play out in the tumor microenvironment. So we did a couple of simple experiments. We took the media from these cancer-associated fibroblasts and added it to the L3.6 cells. These are the drug-resistant cells that I mentioned earlier. And what we saw through TRPAN blue counting and MTT proliferation assay is that these cells were more proliferative if you added the calf-derived media. More importantly, if you added gemcitabine to these cells, the addition of this media from the calves actually made them more drug resistant. So this is where it gets interesting. So we know that there's something that's being released by these fibroblasts that are making them more resistant or makes their media more resistant. So what is that release factor? And this is where I stumbled onto extracellular vesicles. And I always acknowledge that this was not my idea. My grad student at the time, now Dr. Catherine Richards, decided to look at extracellular vesicles. And I famously said, they're not that important, but if you want to waste time and work on it for a little while before you move on to something else, go ahead. And now I spend a lot of time looking at EVs. And so I'm not going to go into too much detail about EVs. We know they're secreted from cells, contain microRNA, DNA, and protein, and that cancer cells can secrete more EVs or exosomes than normal cells. And so what we wanted to know specifically is, you know, what's going on in terms of EV or exosome production from these fibroblasts. And so we isolated exosomes from the fibroblasts through ultracentrifugation. And what we saw was that we were able to confirm through transmission electron microscopy and dynamic light scattering, we were getting vesicles around the range of 30 to 100 nanometers generally in size. And we did a lot of the tetraspanin analysis to kind of confirm that these were EVs, and now generally probably call them exosomes, but I understand there could be a range of vesicles that we're looking at in these samples. And so interesting, what we saw is that when we looked at the calves that were treated with chemotherapy or gemcitabine being what we would call here the GT treated, we saw an increase in a lot of the classic exosome markers like CD81. And here what we have is a fibroblast cell line that's been modified so that it has CD63 GFP fusion. And so when we have increased exosome hypersecretion, should get more fluorescent staining. This is what we see when we treated these cells with gemcitabine or the GT here. We can look at the corrected total cell fluorescence, and we see a big boost in the gemcitabine treated samples, which seems to kind of lead to the suggestion that the cells are hypersecreting exosomes when they're exposed to chemotherapy. So we actually were able to verify that using a nanocyte. And this is very interesting data showing that in all of the cases that we looked at, whether it be the epithelial cancer cell lines, like the PANC1 cells, the L3 cells, or the fibroblast lines, chemotherapy treatment here causes exosome hypersecretion. Now, interestingly, the fibroblasts, whether they be the wild-type fibroblasts or our cancer-associated fibroblasts, secreted the most exosomes. And I'm showing you here data with gemcitabine. We also did nab-paclitaxel. So we know this is probably a general stress response the cells have to chemotherapy. It's not gemcitabine specific, but this chemotherapy treatment causes the release of exosomes more so in the fibroblasts. And so next, to take a look at the role that these fibroblasts actually played in chemo resistance, we took the fibroblast-derived exosomes from these GT-treated samples and added them to our drug-resistant cells, the PANC1 cells or the ASPC1 cells. What we saw here, interestingly, is that the exosomes from these casts were able to increase the total cell number and the surviving cell number when these cells treated with gemcitabine. Now, interestingly, the exosomes from the cells themselves don't have the same effect. So you can use PANC1 exosomes on themselves or the ASPC1 exosomes on themselves, and it doesn't have the same effect as the CAF-derived exosomes. The kind of the really, you know, interesting and scary part here is it seemed to have more of a robust effect in the ASPC1 cells, which are a drug-resistant and metastatic cell line. And so then what we looked at was how to test whether or not these exosomes were really critical for the chemo resistance that we were seeing in these cells. And so we used GW4869, which is a blocker of exosome secretion that lots of people have used, which kind of blocks the ceramide-mediated signaling and release of the late endosomes to produce exosomes. And so what we observed is that if we took a transwell assay system and added the fibroblasts kind of to the top, allowed the exosomes to come through and add the cancer cells on the bottom, we could add GW4869 to the top level and treat how and see how many of the exosomes or the surviving cells were in the kind of bottom channel. When we look at the fluorescent units, what we see is pretty interesting. So we're able to see that gemcitabine, again, as we previously mentioned, actually causes an increase in exosome production. Here, we're using the same GFP labeled cell line that we had earlier. If we add GW4869, we're able to block about 70 to 80% of that signal. So we're reducing the amount of exosomes that we see a lot. And also if we add the gemcitabine, we're able to take that, you know, increase in exosome secretion and knock it down pretty nicely here. And so this was actually something we were able to show actually increases the effect of gemcitabine. So normally if we have the ASPC1 exosomes added to their own cell line, it doesn't do anything. We take the CAF-derived GT exosomes, add them to the ASPC1 cells, we get that increase in chemo resistance. If we add the GW4869, it knocks it down about 50%. So that was quite interesting, even from an initial treatment, showing that the exosome inhibition actually played a significant role in blocking this chemo resistance. Now, we actually did the same thing with just exosome depletion. So instead of using a compound to remove the exosomes, we just use ultracentrifugation to spin the exosomes out of the conditioned media that we would give to the cells. So again, we see that the CAF-derived exosomes, when added to the ASPC1 cells, we show that chemo resistance, in fact, that increase. If we remove the exosomes from the CAF-derived media through exosome depletion, through ultracentrifugation, it knocks it back down, actually more effective than using the inhibitor, which is an interesting point we'll get to later. So this was nice, nice in vitro data showing that this hypothesis that we have about the importance of the fibroblast-derived exosomes in sound, but we kind of wanted to go back to looking in vivo. And so instead of using this kind of culture system, what we did was to combine fibroblast and epithelial cancer cells in vivo into the mouse. And so what we did was to take calf's cancer cells, implant them subcutaneously into the mice, give the tumor kind of a 2-week head start, and then treat with either chemotherapy, gemcitabine, or chemotherapy and the GW4869 exosome inhibitor, and to measure then the tumor size. And what we see is that the tumors, when they're treated with nothing, you know, they just grow fine. If you treat it with gemcitabine, they don't respond at all. It's kind of laugh it off. However, if you give the GW and gemcitabine, we pretty much halt the growth of these tumors. And so just this initial test showed that inhibition of the exosome secretion was able to significantly alter the ability of these tumors to grow, especially in the presence of gemcitabine. And so our basic mechanism at this point was to show that the gemcitabine treatment causes calves to hypersecrete exosomes, and these exosomes are taken up by epithelial cancer cells, which will increase proliferation and drug resistance. And we can block this with a compound like GW4869. The big question then is, what is the mechanism for this? And so in order to kind of get at this, what we did was to do a study where we were funded through the Indiana CTSI to generate a stromal microRNA profile from our cancer-associated fibroblast line. So we looked at wild-type fibroblasts, cancer-associated fibroblasts that had or had not been treated with gemcitabine, isolated the exosomes, and then looked to see which microRNAs increased. We looked at microRNAs first because they're enriched in extracellular vesicles. We also have studies looking at the proteome as well, but I won't talk about those today. And then we decided to really select microRNAs which were associated with chemoresistance and cell survival. And so these were the top five hits that we actually identified, miR-92A, 221, 181A, 222, and 21. And it was interesting to me that this kind of brought me back to a gene that I had known and studied for many different phases of my career, which was P10. So all of these are predicted to target P10. And so it seemed that the extracellular vesicles from the calves were releasing microRNAs that actually have the ability to target P10 function. And so what we did was to go back then and kind of look at the tumors themselves in the study that we'd done, where we saw that using GW4869 and gemcitabine had reduced tumor burden in these mice. And so what we were able to do was to isolate these tumors and show that normally there was a certain level of P10 expression that we saw. We added gemcitabine and actually decreased the P10 expression. When the GW4869 gem-treated samples, that was actually rescued, suggesting again that P10 expression is being restored by exosome blocking therapy. When we looked in vitro to kind of verify these in vivo findings, we saw again that in the ASPC1 cells, the P10 expression is reduced when we have the calf-derived exosomes. And if we deplete the exosomes from the media, we are able to rescue that. Same thing if we look at the L3.6 cells, the cells that are sensitive to gemcitabine, the calf-derived exosomes will suppress P10 expression. Removing the calf-derived exosomes will rescue that effect. When we look at Western blots, we can see the related expression of P10 also going down and AKT expression going up, as you would expect. When we look at the microRNA that was actually the top regulated one in our assay that we saw, which is miR-92A, we could identify that in the exosomes that had come from the calves, what we saw was that miR-92A expression was elevated in the recipient cells. I can tell you, it's not shown here, that the treatment of drugs actually causes the miRs to go up in the fibroblasts. You can see it enriched and increased in the exosomes themselves, and it's also increased in the recipient cells that you see. And same thing when we look at the ASPC1s as well, showing that this miR-92 upregulation is alleviated by GW4869. So this is kind of a summary of the mechanism that we have at this point, showing that miRs that are possibly, you know, targeting P10 along with other factors are really the mechanism through which these calf-derived exosomes are able to increase proliferation and chemoresistance in pancreatic cancer. And so inhibiting exosome signaling will suppress tumor growth and chemoresistance in vivo. And so right now, what I want to do is just kind of switch to how we are really trying to figure out the next step to really dissect this mechanism out further, which will involve looking at the role of the extracellular matrix in this system. Desmoplasia, again, is a really big factor in pancreatic cancer. We have an environment that's rich in type 1 collagen. You have a lot of adhesive molecules like fibronectin involved. And one of the things that's always been an interest to me is the stiffness of pancreatic cancer. Pancreatic cancer is very stiff because of all of this collagen. See, a normal pancreas is about three times as stiff as a tumor pancreas is three times as stiff as a normal. When you take it out, you can actually just feel it. It's stiffer, completely different consistency of normal pancreas. And so the role that this has on the cells is they're actually being squeezed physically in space is something that could have an effect on all of the characteristics that we could evaluate in these cells. We know this is a very complex environment. The cancer cells are surrounded by fibroblasts, or surrounded by immune cells, or surrounded by an extracellular matrix made up of many different molecules. It's going to contribute to this very stiff environment. There are many different factors and enzymes that will help to cleave various factors to create the, you know, different chains that will help to create the total environment that we see in pancreatic cancer. And so what we really wanted to do was to figure out how this environment might actually influence EV secretion itself. So what we did was to look at the difference between ASPC1 cells that are actually plated on 2D plastic and the ASPC1s that are plated in MatriGel. So this is just, you know, growing them in MatriGel compared to 3D. So they kind of form, you know, clusters, little spherical types of structures. And interesting, what we see is that if you take the media from the matrix grown cells, what you see is this media itself, only having changed because it's been in contact with MatriGel, would actually make the recipient cells more chemoresistant. So we could take the ASPC1 derived media that's been in MatriGel, and it makes the L3.6 cells more resistant to chemotherapy, suggesting that something is actually changing just by culturing these cells in the MatriGel itself. Interestingly, we see that looking at CD63 expression by Western blot, the MatriGel grown L3.6 and ASPC1 cells have higher CD63 expression, meaning they actually have higher number of EVs being released and secreted. And so this change of having no ECM present versus having an ECM present has actually caused an increase in exome secretion in the pancreatic cancer cell lines. When we take just these EVs from the MatriGel grown cells and add it to recipient cells that are drug sensitive, we see that these, in the light green here, these extracellular matrix grown EVs increase drug resistance. Now, even to take into account, like, there could be more EVs because of being grown in the MatriGel or even growth factors, if you dilute the number of EVs from these MatriGel grown EV cultures, we still see an increase in chemoresistance, suggesting that the changes that the matrix induces onto these cells will definitely contribute to chemoresistance in this system. So how do we test the role of the ECM in EV-mediated chemoresistance in a tunable system? And this is where I wanted to kind of bridge the gap between what we had been doing using kind of 2D model layers of cells and my, you know, favorite mouse models in vivo. And this is where we decided to cause the creation of a tunable biomimetic matrix model. So what we wanted to do was to even go beyond what's as a normal 3D organoid culture, where you kind of grow organoids in a gel, and to actually create an environment where we have not only fibroblasts, but the ability to actually tune the extracellular matrix components in order to test them individually in this system. And so this was something that my entire group has been working on. It's a very nice workflow that we have. So we can use our mice. So we use the most aggressive lines that we have, the KRAS P10 COX-2 overexpression line. We have other genetic combinations as well. This system is really nice because it allows us to look at the intrinsic role that the genetic alterations and different combinations play in this system as well. We take the tumors from these mice, digest them, grow the organoids and the calves as well, and to let them grow into organoids that we use for various organoid assays in my lab. We've been able to validate that these organoids are from the pancreas, that they have the same markers that you'll see. They're very cystic in nature, which is kind of classic of pancreatic organoids as well. And so what we see here is kind of the formula for this. And one of the things I want to point out is that these calves, when we add them to this system, they are interspersed in 3D with the organoids. They actually touch the organoids. Well, we didn't want to have a system where we're layering organoids on top and having the calves at the bottom. We know that there could be secretion and passing of factors through this, but we wanted to actually come up with a condition that actually gets everybody nice and happy and growing in the same place, just like you have in the actual body. Again, we wanted to really recapitulate the exact scenario that we have in vivo. And so thanks to some ingenious work by my postdoc, we were able to create this system where we have organoids and the actual mouse matching calves, along with the ability to tune the ECM through the various concentrations of Matrigel or different ECM factors as well. And so one of the things that we first wanted to look at was how the actual ECM causes a change in the EV production of the calves. And so again, just taking the calves and taking them from a 2D environment to an environment where there is the ECM present caused either a 40% or a 200% increase and EV production is marked by CD63 expression, as you can see in this Western blot. And so this was quite interesting. It really suggested that the EVs themselves are going to be changing in terms of how many of them are going to be produced from not only epithelial cells, but the calves as well. One of the things that's quite interesting is that the calf presence causes the ECM to be stiffer. What we were able to actually look at is the role of the calves in cross-linking and stiffening the actual gel itself. And so what you're seeing here is actually a measurement of the gel contraction in this system. And so what we see is that we take these tumor organoids and put them in solo culture, they take up a certain amount of space. Now, if we co-culture them with fibroblasts, what we see is that that space actually shrinks. The gel is actually contracting and getting stiffer just because of the presence of the calves itself. And so unfortunately, due to the interest of time, I don't have time to go in through the work of my postdoc here. But what we really believe now is the proposed mechanism is that the calves are actually causing the ECM to stiffen. And this is causing these calves to go from a normal state to more of even a hyperactive state. And this causes them to secrete even more exosomes, which will be taken up by the cancer cells to lead to more proliferation and chemo resistance. And the interesting thing about this tunable model that we have is that we can test intervention in all these different steps. And this is what Wei Kun is actually doing at many different steps, testing compounds that can inhibit the stiffening, the ability of the stiffened ECM to actually signal or be recognized by the hyperactive calves, or the ability of the hyperactive calves or even the epithelial cells to secrete anything in general. And so in the interest of time, I'm going to actually just talk about this last stage of the intervention, the ability to block these extracellular vesicles from being released from the calves. And this is something that we initially wanted to do because of a couple of problems with GW4869. GW4869, it can be highly toxic, and it's also something that's not FDA approved. And so I had Flora, my technician, to really look at whether or not we could see the same effects that we had seen in GW4869 with FDA-approved compounds. And so this would cause us to do two things. One, not reinvent the wheel, to look for compounds that could do what had already been identified in some other compounds, and to really test therapeutic potential of our kind of hypothesis that these EV-blocking compounds could improve the efficacy of gemcitabine. And so there was a paper that came on Scientific Reports that did a great job of actually identifying several different compounds that could block EV production in various stages along this pathway here. A lot of them working in the same way, looking at the late endosome production to create exosomes. And so what we did was to kind of take five top candidates that we identified from this paper and some additional studies that we did to figure out if this would be usable in our system. So what we did was first to test this in our 2D model layer system by looking at the PANC1 cells to see how these compounds could effectively prevent the gemcitabine-induced EV secretion that we'd kind of seen. So what we normally see, again, is that the gemcitabine treatment causes a hypersecretion of exosomes, and we were able to show in this pilot study that GW4869, along with the other kind of candidate compounds that we identified, were able to knock down that EV production back to kind of a baseline level, which is very exciting. And so we wanted to then kind of use this in our biomimetic model that we had designed. So kind of the first thing I want to point out is that this model does actually recapitulate the CAF-mediated chemoresistance that we've seen in our 2D model and in vivo. If we look at treating the solo culture with gemcitabine, we see that co-culture with the CAFs actually increases the gemcitabine resistance of the organoids. And as you can see here in these pictures, just showing how treating the solo cultures in Matrigel or in Matrigel with added collagen, you can get rid of a lot of the organoids, but the co-culture with fibroblasts and make the organoids grow like crazy there. Interestingly, as we also can show that the number of fibroblasts actually matters. So again, the thing I kind of want to recapitulate is that ability to have increased number of fibroblasts. So if we take the same co-culture system, add no fibroblasts, add a 1-to-1 fibroblast to organoid ratio or 1-to-10 fibroblast ratio, we can see that more fibroblasts lead to more organoid growth. But interestingly, one of the compounds we identify, climbazole, which is an antifungal compound, actually, it actually blocked the growth of the organoids and blocked their EV production. So we see about a 94 or 40% reduction, depending on which one of the organoid lines we actually test with this system. Again, showing that just blocking EV alone was able to prevent the organoid growth. Another compound that we really like, emipramine, which is actually something that had been kind of repurposed for a lot of different cancer studies as an antidepressant. We found that just like climbazole, this drug could also by itself block the growth of organoid cultures compared to vehicle treatment alone. And so this was kind of nice, again, showing that just blocking EV secretion is having a pronounced effect on these organoid cultures to even grow. And even more exciting, if we actually combine it with gemcitabine, we will get even further reduction of this from some initial studies that we've actually done. Now, how much of an effect this will be in terms of long-term studies and how effective this would be in other combinations is something that we're working on. We're also very interested in looking at how the exact mechanism of each of these drugs is related to EV blockage in this scenario compared to what it should initially do. So again, we're looking at things like fungal inhibitors, antidepressants, which are thought to, in some cases not have any anti-cancer role, but are blocking EV formation, seemingly leading to more effective chemotherapy. And so in summary, just your take-home messages, I want to just kind of say that hopefully now you believe me that CAF-derived EVs play an important role in pancreatic ductal adenocarcinoma chemoresistance and that compounds that block EV hypersecretion are potential therapeutics, especially the ones that we have identified that are FDA approved. And the use of a tunable biomimetic model will allow us to investigate the role of the ECM in the EV-mediated chemoresistance. So my lab primarily focuses on the role of the tumor microenvironment in general and a lot of different things. We've looked at the role of the environment in looking at metastasis through things like MTSS1 stabilization, the exosome hypersecretion I've talked about, the current studies into ECM stiffening, ER stress, and also a big part of my lab is where it's really interested in looking at the role of EVs from the fibroblast in the ability to detect pancreatic cancer early. So a lot of studies I'm very proud of with my colleagues at the University of Notre Dame. Unfortunately, we'll have time to talk about, but we have several papers about EVs and prognostic and diagnostic use using a microfluidic device, engineering collaborators there as well. So for future directions, we're really interested in looking at how the intra and intercellular exosome heterogeneity will play a role in pancreatic cancer tumor initiation, progression, chemoresistance, as well as continuing to really monitor the efficacy of these different treatments that we've identified for improving the efficacy of currently available pancreatic cancer treatments, and also looking at how ER stress might actually nicely intersect with all the other things that we've already kind of done. And so for acknowledgments, again, I have to thank some great funding from the Walther Cancer Foundation, American Cancer Society, NIH, the NASCTSI, and InDesign. Melissa Fischel, who was very instrumental in helping us with the derivation of the CAF lines that are kind of the foundation for our study. My colleagues at Notre Dame who worked on the engineering project that unfortunately don't have time to talk to you about, Dr. Amanda Humman, who works on the proteome aspect of this, which I don't have time to talk about, Dr. Timothy Donahue, researcher at UCLA, who's been instrumental in helping me with this throughout the years. Our colleagues at the Children's Hospital of Los Angeles, who work on the EV field with us, colleagues at USC for a variety of different helpful conversations, and the Ellison Institution, again, it's a great place to work. Thank you for the support. David Agus, great advice, mentor. Shannon Mumenthaler, also very instrumental with lots of conversations about these projects. Many different people at the EI who help us. And I can't do anything without my lab. I've been very fortunate to have an amazing group of people to work with me. And they do all the heavy lifting, so I seem like I know what I'm doing. Be sure to check out our website if you're looking. I'm actively recruiting postdocs, grad students, technicians of all disciplines. Half of my lab is engineers right now. They're doing a fantastic job. I really like to look at this from an interdisciplinary kind of perspective. And so with that, I know I ran over time what I was supposed to do, but I'll take questions in the remaining time. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much, Reginald. So I think I ask Elham to start with the QA.
Sure. E.G. Vaughn, you are the first in the queue for your question. Thank you so much, Reginald, for an amazing talk.
Thank you so much for the wonderful talk. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Yes.
Okay. Yeah, I just wondered, how did you make the matrix gel?
So
for the 3D organoid? Yes.
Yeah. And so the matrix gel is made of like kind of normal matrix gel, like added with some like different components that are kind of added in the mix. I can't give you the specifics. My postdoc can. I'll tell him to actually message you the exact, you know, kind of formulation that we do it. It's kind of a concoction that he made that he kind of mixes together. And then there's a special way that we kind of seed it so that the actual cells don't sink all the way through to the bottom.
Yeah. The thing I there are like several ways to make a matrix gel for the 3D organoid, to make the 3D organoid. The thing I'm concerned is if you put them the collagen, I know that the collagen itself is a bit like acidic. So the matrix gel itself would be like a bit like acidic. So maybe your cell would be cultured a little bit like acidic like an environment. So I've read like several papers that if you culture cancer cells in a little bit like a low pH medium, then they release more EVs. So I just wonder if it is like pH related or really like that kind of matrix or more dense environment, ECM environment release. Related.
We haven't looked at that, and that's something that we should look at. I'll have my postdoc follow up on that to see if that is something that we're looking at. I'm not sure in terms of how different the pH is from normal matrix gel to what we're actually looking at.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Wong, you're next.
Hey, nice talk. So you compared the EV production by doing Western blood of CD63 from 2D and 3D organoid conditions. And I'm wondering how you normalize the CD63 level between 2D and 3D. And how can you say the CD63 level is different?
Yeah, that's something. So we also did like quantification with nanosite analysis as well. And so that is something that we're trying to figure out, like how to say that's actually truly normalized comparing the number of EVs that you get from a 2D versus a 3D culture and whether or not it's actually the contents that are different compared to the actual number. So I agree that is.
No, I mean, okay. So your 2D condition and 3D condition have the different cell numbers, right?
Yes.
Okay, you cannot normalize the EV production.
We tried it. We have used the same cell numbers for extracting on some of our experiments, though.
But in 2D condition, you don't have the tumor tissue. But in organoid, you have the tumor tissue.
Well, we have the organoids, yeah.
Then some EV could be secreted from tumor tissue as well.
Yeah, and so that's one of the things in terms of, like, if you look at the organoids, it's just the epithelial layer. Okay. And so what we have tried to do is to normalize that as much as possible for how many cells we are looking at when we look at just the organoid solo culture compared to the actual 2D culture cell number. So that is something that we've tried to come up with a great way of actually normalizing that between the 2D and the 3D. And so that is something that trying to say if it's the bigger deal that the 2D and 3D is different, I'm not actually so concerned about, because I think the 3D model is better because we have the better options to recapitulate the actual tumor environment itself. But I do, your point is well taken.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
John, do you want to go?
Great talk. Thanks for doing this. My question is, how do you know that the climazole would work? And do you know what the mechanism for climazole is for blocking the secretion of exosomes? And then I actually have a third one, which is, are the exosomes still produced in the cell, or do they get digested, or what happens to them because of the climazole?
So we did not know it would work at all. So that was the initial kind of point of the pilot, was to see if this antifungal, which is found in like shampoos in some cases, would actually work. And so no, we did not expect it to work. And then we just had to test it to see if it first would block EVs, and then if it had any effect in solo studies or in chemo-resistant studies with gemcitabine. So in terms of the mechanism, we don't know yet. And so that's where we're collecting a lot of samples right now to do a study to see what's actually changed in the climazole treated samples, to see if there are any factors that are obvious and kind of in terms of how this might affect EV production. And if they're still being digested, if they're releasing the cells, I'm not sure how to answer that. I think that as far as we can tell, I mean, we haven't had a chance to kind of fully characterize all of them, but the treatments aren't doing anything to disrupt normal EV production. They're still exosomes or EVs being released.
Thanks.
Okay. Thank you, Reginald. And I think last question is from Camille.
Hi, great talk. I just want to ask if you tried other exosome inhibitors. And I think in your mice studies, I was just wondering if you ever looked at the plasma of these mice, or like within the tumor microenvironment of the mice, if you did see an increase in microvesicles, because there's like some reports. I think I've seen some papers wherein they were showing that when you use this inhibitor, the GW4869, that there is an increase in microvesicle production.
You know, we have not seen that in vivo. We do have a couple of, you know, outlier studies, which are very important to pay attention to, that have shown in vitro increased vesicle production with GW treatment. And so we didn't look in the in vivo study for that. But we know generally that the exosome number and microvesicle mirrors have gone up in mice that do have tumors. But in terms of the treatment with GW, have not looked at that yet, because we moved away from
it. Did you profile those microvesicles, like what's in them? Like what's the changes in the in vitro studies?
Besides the changes that I mentioned, like in the P10 targeting mirrors, there are a bunch of different mirrors, and we were looking at the proteome for those as well. So we have some protein changes and some mirror changes, but not in the ones that, you know, we haven't looked at GW anymore since kind of the initial toxicity questions. We've kind of moved on to the other studies, but we haven't looked at GW treated EVs, only the ones that are from the calves that are treated with gemcitabine or not.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much again. I think that's all for the questions.
Thank you so much, Elham. And Reginald, thanks so much for sharing your project today. So it's very interesting, and you've got such a wonderful mouse models that will help so much in characterizing the role of extracellular vesicles in this case.